That's what an objection is. I don't want to do that, but I want to do this over here. And I think as agents, we've been programmed to take that and try to twist it around to where we try to close them now, you know, on handling that objection. And I think that instead, if you listen to what they're saying, they're basically telling you what they want to do. And then from that point, you say, cool, let me help you do that, right? Most people, their first year goals is really the goal that they hit realistically in their second year. Some people are like, I want to do 100,000 my first year. And, you know, for most people, that's very unrealistic. People have hit that. But, and I'm not here to tell anybody they can't do anything. Like, I know a guy that did 100 deals his first year. Several people that did 50 deals their first year. That stuff's unheard of. But most of the time, just generally speaking, that first year lofty goal that people make for themselves is really what their second year needs to be after they've set the foundation of knowledge and, you know, so on and so forth, right? Everything I just talked about. So realize like how massively incredible of a position that you're in right now, that you are in your first year with 8 deals. It is great. It's not good. It is great. It's greatness. Now it's going to be the thing where, okay, can you actually take that to a place of greatness in your second, third, and fourth year, right? And that's going to be up to you. And that's going to depend on really just one thing. Are you going to continue to prospect for new people and talk to new people on a daily basis for the next 3, 4, 5 years? Or are you going to do what some agents do who plateau at $150,000 a year and prospect new people until they hit $150,000 and then try to live off that database thinking that they're going to grow their income off that database? When you start living off your database, guys, your income plateaus and you'll make the same amount of money every year. And you see this a lot. You see people who do $150,000 or $250,000 and that's all they do. That's a ceiling they hit. And they do that every year, year in and year out. And you never see them, you know, go up to $300 or $350 or $500. And the reason is because they quit building their database. And so if you want to see exponential growth, you have to always be working your current database. That's why I like the weekly email. It nurtures that database. But then also have a steady flow of people you've never talked to and creating those great first impressions and creating those relationships to add to. And most agents are either doing one or the other. They're nurturing their database or they're just going after new people. And the ones going after new people is like a turn and burn. They're not trying to create a relationship. They're just like, if they do a deal, great. If they don't, whatever. They're not staying in touch. And they're just like, it's always new people coming in and out of their business. And then some people just work their database. Those are the people that plateau their business. But when you see these people that go from like 150 to 250 to 500 to 750 to 750 for 3 years and then 1.1 and stuff like that, those are people that have understood that I have to accumulate the new people that I'm talking to into something where I can nurture them, where now I'm nurturing everyone I've ever talked to, but also talking to new people every day. That's how you blow up. When you get them talking about what the backstory is behind why they're selling, and when they start talking about that, you know that you got them feeling comfortable, right? And that's going to come from tone of how you deliver that question and your entire demeanor from up to that point. And then once you get them talking about why they want to sell, if you're actually getting engaging in a conversation with them about why they want to sell and everything, kind of taking the real estate part out of the equation for a second and just focusing on them as a person and why they're trying to sell, you're going to close so many more appointments, so many more. And then once you get through that, then pop the question about why you guys are going by owner. Right? And now you got them feeling comfortable before you even start going in that direction with the conversation, because you're relating to them as a human before even talking about the real estate stuff, right? So I think that if you kind of change your mindset a little bit around on some of those things, I think you're going to find way more engaging conversations with your prospects and much more success. So take me to the point of what someone says when they're basically shutting you down for the appointment. When you have these discounters out there and you're firm on this 4%, you got to understand that you are going to lose listings over that. you know, and the ones that you lose over that, you have to say in your head, I knew that was going to happen. This is going to happen here and there. And there's really nothing you can do about that, because at the end of the day, all they see is dollars. Right, that's all that seller sees is dollars. You can try to, and like a lot of these coaches and brokerages, you know, they have these, you know, slick way. They'll try to tell you that, you know, there's ways that you can show them the value of paying the extra 1% or 1.5% or 2% or whatever, you know. And yeah, you could. But at the end of the day, it's like all they're looking at is numbers and they see that they're paying less over here. That's what they're going to do. They don't care what you say. So you're going to lose deals when it comes to that. I think when the dust settles from all this discounting and stuff, we'll see where things really stand, because, you know, like the Zillow thing, for example, that just went down. You know, that was, you could see that coming a mile away. I mean, there's no way you can lose money on houses. You can only lose money on houses for so long, going into an escalating market, and then what's going to happen when you own thousands of houses and the market crashes? I think what they did was smart, because they're basically saying, wait a minute, you know, if we own these 7,000 houses when the market crash, we're really going to be in trouble. You know, if we dump them now, we're just in this much trouble, but if we wait and keep doing what we're doing, we're going to be in this much trouble. You know, and so with the discounters, I feel like it's kind of the same thing, because, you know, you got to think, how are they making money, right? How are you making money on, you know, 1%, you know, when you have all these expenses and everything else? When you look at the brokerages, you know, like the Redfins, for example, you know, they're still running negative. You know, maybe they pull themselves out of their, you know, negative profit, you know, somehow. And they did, like, they just came out with their earnings report, and they did lessen their losses a little, right? But we'll see how that plays out. It's just like there's so much expenses, and the customer service, right? When it comes to customer service, a lot of these discounters are not giving you the customer service, and I think it's all going to come back to customer service and relationships. So the number one reason why people choose a real estate agent is because they had a friend in the business, right? NAR actually did a study, and it was the number one reason that they had a friend in the business with a great reputation. So at the end of the day, you know, when you're talking to these people, like for sale by owners and stuff, for the very first time, and there's no relationship established, you know, and you're just trying to like close an appointment and get a listing, that's a totally different situation than when you've been in the business for a long time, you've accumulated a lot of relationships, you've nurtured those relationships, these people have known you for a while, they love you, and they're, you know, they're gonna do business with you and nobody else when you establish that kind of brand. But you don't have that in the beginning, right? So you're a new agent, Joseph, so you don't have years of accumulation and nurturing of clients and stuff, but you need to be thinking 3 years out, you know, that right now, as you are trying to close these deals, you also need to be establishing relationships with all these people, putting them into a database and nurturing them as you go along and continue to accumulate. That's where all this stuff is never going to matter, because it's not going to matter about the discount brokers down the road. It's not going to matter about the iBuyers. It's not going to matter about any of that, because you're going to have such a large database of people who just are dying to do business with you because you brought them so much value and you're a hard worker and they just value you as a person, that it doesn't matter. Right, they're going to come use you and pay you your extra 1% because they know for a fact you're going to take care of them. That's like a lender. If an agent has a lender that they've been working with for a while and they know does a great job for them, they're not going to go use another lender and risk this one deal with this client to see if this lender can do a good job. It's too risky when you know that this lender is going to really slam dunk it. You know how they operate, and they know that your client's going to have a great experience. It's the same thing. When a client knows that an agent is really good and they feel really comfortable with them, they're not going to go try out a Redfin. They're not going to go try out another agent because they feel comfortable here, and that's how business works, right? And the biggest thing is be straight up with them about, you know, if you guys like don't sell it, you know, within the next, you know, month or so, are you going to You know, listed, do you plan on actually hiring a real estate agent? And do you have a real estate agent in mind? You know, be very straight up with them about it. One thing I love about for sale by owners is I look at those as buyer leads. I'm trying to figure out where they're moving, if they already have an agent they're working with on their next, you know, wherever they're moving to, whatever their next purchase is. Maybe they've already made the purchase, you know, or whatever. I want to dig into that whole situation and dissect it out and see, okay, how can I help here, right? Are they buying something? Do they need help there? Do they just need help, you know, selling this? And if they don't sell it within the next month, they're going to possibly list it. They don't really have an agent they're going to list it with, and I need to establish this relationship. So until you dig in and really dissect the whole situation, you really don't know what direction to go in. But I would say don't be so laser focused on just closing for an appointment and closing for the listing, because there could be much more opportunity there than meets the eye when you start digging in. You know what I mean? Another thing with objections are that really objections, if you really think about it, that's just your client telling you what they want to do. It's not really like an objection, right? You're basically throwing something out there and then they're giving you something back, basically saying, well, I don't want to do this. This is what they're saying in layman's terms. I don't want to do that, but I want to do this. That's what an objection is. I don't want to do that, but I want to do this over here. And I think as agents, we've been programmed to take that and try to twist it around to where we try to close them now, you know, on handling that objection. And I think that instead, if you listen to what they're saying, they're basically telling you what they want to do. And then from that point, you say, cool, let me help you do that, right? So